Good evening. I'm Jeff Bennett.
And I'm Amna Nawaz. On the NewsHour tonight, Rudy Giuliani is ordered to pay $148 million to two election workers for defamation.
Displaced Gazan civilians bear the brunt of continuing Israeli airstrikes in areas where they sought refuge, as the U.S. calls for a more precise offensive.
And the latest court ruling over abortion access in Texas highlights the roadblocks and dangers faced during pregnancy in much of the country.
Physicians are placed in a situation where they are unsure whether what they consider to be their sound, reasonable judgment would be acceptable to our attorney general or to judges in the state of Texas.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions, and friends of the NewsHour, including Jim and Nancy Bildman and Kathy and Paul Anderson.
It was like an aha moment. This is what I love doing.
Early stage companies have this energy that energizes me. These are people who are trying to change the world. When I volunteer with women entrepreneurs, it's the same thing. I'm helping people reach their dreams.
I'm thriving by helping others every day.
People who know BDO.
The John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, fostering informed and engaged communities. More at kf.org.
And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to the NewsHour. As we come on the air, a verdict tonight in one of the cases related to the 2020 election.
Earlier this evening, a federal jury in Washington ordered Rudy Giuliani, Donald Trump's former campaign attorney, to pay $148 million to two former Georgia election workers for distress caused by lies he spread following the 2020 election. NPR's Miles Park was in the courtroom today and joins us now. So, Miles, we should say this was a civil trial, and the jury was asked only to decide the amount of damages. Here's what Rudy Giuliani told reporters on his way out of the courtroom today.
Very little I could say right now. I have to analyze this. Obviously, possibly we'll move for a new trial. Certainly we'll appeal. The absurdity of the number merely underscores the absurdity of the entire proceeding.
So he's calling that number, the $148 million, absurd. How did the jury arrive at that number, and what message were they trying to send?
I mean, it is a staggering number, isn't it? I think throughout the entire week, the plaintiff's attorneys were trying to make the case that the jury should send a message that election lies, especially when the people pushing them are essentially using real people and who are getting caught up as casualties. This is not acceptable. You know, it made it clear that they wanted the jury to repair the women's reputation, but more than that, they wanted them to send a message that this is not how healthy democracies behave.
We heard from both Shea Moss and Ruby Freeman, who were subject to Rudy Giuliani's lies about them. Here's what Ms. Freeman told reporters.
Money will never solve all of my problems. I can never move back into the house that I called home. I will always have to be careful about where I go and who I choose to share my name with.
How did their attorneys make the case to the jury that the extreme emotional distress, their damaged reputations, that was worth X amount?
Well, it really was kind of a two-prong approach where you had the practical aspect, and they made that case. They had an expert witness who was a marketing professor from Northwestern come in and show how these lies reached tens of millions of Americans in the time after voting ended in 2020, and then had her put together a strategic communications plan, essentially, what it would cost to counter those lies and repair the reputation. That estimate was put at roughly $47 million. And so then on top of that, then they said, and how do you measure, essentially, the emotional toll of this? And both women who were affected testified. Both women got emotional, cried on the stand. The jurors and the public saw, I mean, more death threats than I could count. We heard racist voicemails that were left for these women that Shay Moss's son reportedly heard. And so all of that was kind of taken into consideration when the jury was coming up with this $148 million number.
We heard Rudy Giuliani say an appeal is on the way. What happens next?
It's a little bit unclear. He says he's going to appeal. I mean, throughout this entire process, one of the strange things about this is that while the attorneys for the plaintiffs say they want to send a message that this is not acceptable, Rudy Giuliani has continued to say these lies that he is being sued for here. On Monday, after court ended on the courthouse steps, Rudy Giuliani said, everything I've said about those women is true, and said again that they stole the election. So what's next? I think he is clearly indicating that he's going to appeal this decision. I think what's a little more unclear is how this penalty is going to affect whether he and whether the former president, whether other people who have continued to spread these lies over the last few years, whether this affects whether they continue to do that looking ahead at 2024.
NPR's Miles Parks, thanks for coming in straight from the courtroom today. We appreciate
thanks,
it.
Jeff.
There is fresh tragedy tonight in the war between Israel and Hamas. Israeli troops mistakenly shot and killed three hostages today in Gaza City. That news came as Israel kept up an unrelenting bombardment of Gaza, and a top American envoy pressed them to curtail the combat.
As Israel pounds the Gaza Strip with airstrikes and IDF troops advance on the ground, U.S. National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan today laid out his vision for the future of a more limited war.
There will be a transition to another phase of this war, one that is focused in more precise ways on targeting the leadership and on intelligence-driven operations that continues to deal with the ongoing threat that Hamas poses.
Later in the occupied West Bank, Sullivan spoke with Palestinian Authority President Mahmoud Abbas on Gaza after the war. The U.S. wants the Palestinian Authority to help govern, a plan Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu rejects.
There is disagreement about the day after Hamas. I will not allow the entry into Gaza of those who educate for terrorism, support terrorism, and finance terrorism.
Abbas also expressed concern today for Palestinians outside of Gaza, telling Sullivan that the U.S. must, quote, intervene to force Israel to stop its aggression against our people in the West Bank, including occupied Jerusalem. The West Bank has seen an uptick in violence since October 7th, both by extremist Israeli settlers and the IDF, killing at least 287 Palestinians. In the Gaza Strip, the death toll is quickly approaching 20,000. Outside of a hospital in Rafah this morning, mourners, including Yusuf Abed, prayed and wept for victims yet to be identified.
Until now, no one came to confirm their identities. So we hope that someone comes to identify and bury them. We need people to identify their children who are dead, to know where they are from.
He fears there is no one left who could recognize them. The IDF announced this morning it recovered the bodies of three Israeli hostages in Gaza: Elia Toledano, taken from the Nova Music Festival, and soldiers Ron Sherman and Nick Beiser. The IDF later reported the death of three other hostages by friendly fire, which they're investigating: Samer Tolalka, Yotam Chaim, and Alon Shamriz. Also today, the world's largest shipping company, Maersk, said it is pausing all container ship traffic through the Red Sea indefinitely, citing safety concerns. This after repeated missile strikes on commercial vessels by Houthi rebels in Yemen, backed by Iran, who say they're targeting ships headed for Israel. The attacks have renewed concerns that the war could spread into a broader regional conflict.
Earlier this week, both CNN and The Washington Post reported that the U.S. intelligence community believes that 40% to 45% of the bombs that Israel has dropped in Gaza were unguided, so-called dumb bombs, as opposed to precision munitions, which are much more accurate. Israel says it has struck over 22,000 terror targets in Gaza since the Hamas attacks on October 7th. An Israeli military spokesman defended the use of unguided bombs, telling the NewsHour in a statement that, quote, the IDF strikes military targets of the Hamas terrorist organization based on high-quality intelligence while using high-quality munitions that are operated by skilled pilots and advanced systems. The type of munitions used in each strike is determined according to the characteristics of the target, the operational need, and the effort to mitigate harm to civilians. Two perspectives now on the Israeli use of unguided bombs in Gaza. Retired Lieutenant General David Deptula had a 36-year career in the Air Force and played major roles in planning American bombing campaigns in numerous wars, including Iraq in 1991 and Afghanistan in 2001. And Mark Galasco was the chief of high-value targeting at the Defense Intelligence Agency from 1997 to 2003. He led teams that planned attacks while limiting civilian deaths. He then worked for Human Rights Watch, where he investigated attacks against civilians. With a welcome to you both. Mark, I'll start with you. What's your reaction to reports that 40 to 45% of the bombs that Israel is dropping in Gaza have been unguided?
Well, honestly, I'm really shocked. You know, there's three reasons that you want to use precision-guided munitions. You want to destroy your target with minimal civilian harm while upholding the laws of war. And there's nothing that's going to do a better job of doing that than a precision-guided munition, especially compared to an unguided bomb. Precision-guided munitions, you're looking at about a 3-meter error, and an unguided bomb, you could have upwards of missing your target by 100 feet. That's highly problematic. And let's just look at U.S. practice. In 91, 8% of all bombs dropped on Iraq were precision. In 99, there were 33% of the bombs dropped on Serbia were precision. Then in 02 and 03, we had 65% of all bombs were precision guided for Afghanistan and Iraq. And by Libya in 2011, it was 100%. But really, it's not just the use of unguided munitions that's leading to so many civilian deaths in Gaza. It's the choices that Israel's making of not applying civilian harm mitigation, of not using smaller weapons and with less blast and fragmentation like the GBU-39 that they could be using. And this is why we're seeing upwards of 20,000 dead Palestinians right now.
General Deptula, I want to get your reaction to what Mark Galasco just had to say. And why is it okay for Israel to use unguided bombs when the U.S. doesn't use them anymore?
Well, Jeff, what I'd tell you is the use of a weapon is highly dependent upon the effects that need to be accomplished, the collateral damage concerns regarding a particular target, and the accuracy of the weapon system in its entirety, not just the bomb itself. A dumb bomb delivered by a smart aircraft can still be accurate. So there are legitimate reasons to use low-cost dumb bombs. An example is hitting a weapon storage location in an area where intelligence has determined there are no collateral damage or civilian casualty concerns. In other cases, there are fleeting targets that don't allow for the process of obtaining coordinates for GPS-guided weapons or obstacles that prevent a laser-guided delivery. So the pilot with a precise delivery system can quickly get to the target and deliver accurately before the opportunity evaporates. The bottom line is, I've seen the exquisite care the Israeli Defense Force takes to avoid civilian casualties. They have extraordinarily stringent rules for avoiding collateral damage. And I'm told by a very good source that Israel only uses dumb bombs after they clear an area.
Mark, your response to the notion that unguided bombs can be dropped in a precise way. And is Israel using this weapons because they don't have enough precision-guided bombs in their arsenal?
Well, I certainly agree that unguided weapons can be used in an accurate way in certain circumstances. But we're talking here about 10 to 15,000 unguided bombs being dropped in one of the most densely populated parts of the Earth. And this is incredibly dangerous. Now, looking at the weapons transfers that are put publicly out by the Defense Security Cooperation Agency, we can see that over 35,000 guided weapons have been provided to Israel in recent years. And that doesn't include the weapons that were provided just this year, and that right now is classified. But let's take again a look at U.S. practice. When I was in the Pentagon and conducting targeting there for the Iraq War, for example, in 2003, We were dropping munitions in Baghdad and throughout different cities in Iraq. And at no time did I ever have a weaponeer suggest to me that we should use an unguided munition. And let's take a look at a very similar conflict, right? Let's look at Raqqa in Syria, where the U.S. was involved with a lot of aerial munitions. There's a great story. There's a quote there from a pilot talking about how you have all of these buildings around, a densely populated area, the enemy commingled with civilians. And the pilot asks, how am I supposed to fly the plane and drop a bomb down an alleyway? And the answer that the report comes up with is precision-guided munitions.
General, when President Biden described Israel's bombing campaign as indiscriminate, as he did this past week, I'd imagine you take issue with that.
Yeah, actually, I would. It was an extraordinarily unfortunate and indiscriminate use of the term indiscriminate attacks. And I think definitions are important here. In accordance with the international humanitarian law, indiscriminate attacks are defined as, first, attacks which are not directed at specific military objectives. Second, attacks which employ a means of combat that cannot be directed at a specific military objective. Or third, attacks which employ a means of combat the effects of which cannot be limited as required by international humanitarian law, and consequently are of a nature to strike military objectives and civilians or civilian objects without distinction. None of these situations apply to the Israeli Air Force.
That is retired Lieutenant General David Deptula and Mark Galasko. We thank you both for your insights.
Thank you.
You bet, Jeff. Thank you.
In the day's other headlines, the Congressional Budget Office projected inflation will slow to near 2% next year. That is close to the Federal Reserve's goal, and it could pave the way for lower interest rates. The CBO also estimates that unemployment will rise to 4.4% by late next year. The nation's gross domestic product, or overall economic output, is expected to fall to a rate of 1.5% before rebounding in 2025. Homelessness in the United States has soared to its highest levels on record, more than 650,000 people. Federal data released today showed a 12% increase in January from a year earlier. The numbers are increasingly evident in Chicago, Denver, and other cities. Officials blame sharply higher rents and the end of pandemic-era assistance. European Union leaders insisted today they will ultimately get more military aid to Ukraine early next year. Germany, France, and others voiced optimism despite Hungary's veto of a $50 billion aid package. Hungarian Prime Minister Viktor Orban is Russia's closest ally in the EU. He defended his position in Brussels as an EU summit ended.
We can say the situation in Ukraine is bad. So we shouldn't send any more money to finance the war. Instead, we should stop the war and have a ceasefire and peace talks. Instead of that, now they want to give money to keep the war going.
The EU aid is especially critical for Ukraine, with future U.S. assistance stuck in Congress. Meanwhile, the bloc will begin talks on letting Ukraine join, but Hungary's Orban says he may stop that process later. Russian officials now say the jailed opposition leader Alexei Navalny has been moved from a penal colony east of Moscow. Confirmation came today during a court hearing. But Navalny's whereabouts remain unknown since his lawyer lost touch with him after December 6th. Moscow is digging out from one of its biggest snowstorms in 60 years. Blizzards dumped 8 inches on the Russian capital and other parts of the country today. It amounted to more than 1/5 of Moscow's average December snowfall in just 24 hours. Forecasters say the city could get a record of nearly 20 inches this month. A bitter cold wave has plunged much of China to below freezing temperatures. Snow blanketed Beijing this week and disrupted highway travel in provinces across the north. Today, President Xi Jinping called for an all-out emergency response, with conditions set to worsen over the weekend. Britain's Prince Harry scored a victory today in his legal war with British tabloids. A London court ruled the Daily Mirror used phone hacking to snoop on Harry in the early 2000s, and it awarded him $180,000. Later, lawyers read a statement from the prince calling for action against publishers who abuse their power.
Today's ruling is vindicating and affirming. I've been told that slaying dragons will get you burned. But in light of today's victory and the importance of what is needed for a free and honest press, it is a worthwhile price to pay.
Prince Harry's testimony in the trial was the first by a British royal in more than a century. Back in this country, former President Trump faces a new controversy over highly classified documents that disappeared as he left office. Reports today say it involves a binder of material on Russian efforts to meddle in the 2016 election. Intelligence agencies are said to be worried that secret sources and methods will be compromised. The Virginia woman whose first grader shot and wounded his teacher was sentenced today to 2 years in state prison for child neglect. Deja Taylor's son used her gun in the attack in Newport News. She'd already been sentenced to 21 months in federal prison for using marijuana while owning a gun. And on Wall Street, stocks had a mixed day but closed out another winning week. The Dow Jones Industrial Average gained 56 points to close at 37,305. The Nasdaq rose 52 points and the S&P 500 slipped a fraction of a point. Still to come on the NewsHour. David Brooks and Ruth Marcus weigh in on the week's political headlines. And book critics share their picks for the best reads of the year.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
The landmark Supreme Court decision overturning Roe v. Wade nearly 18 months ago upended the American landscape of reproductive rights. State laws popped up restricting abortion access. The issue became central to some elections. And we've heard many stories of confusion from patients and doctors trying to understand the new limits.
A new story from the New York Times explains some of the internal dynamics of the court, from how the justices decided to hear the case to how the decision was drafted and when it was ultimately handed down. Jody Cantor is one of the authors of that report, and she joins us now. Thank you for being with us. Jody, many of the justices, including Justice Amy Coney Barrett, who was picked by Donald Trump in part to help overturn Roe, according to your reporting, initially opposed even hearing the case. What changed?
When Adam Liptak and I were reporting the story, that was one of the big surprises, because, of course, she did eventually vote to overturn the law. But voting whether to take the case or not is a different matter. And initially what she said was that she wanted to vote to grant to hear the case, but that she had timing reservations, that she didn't want to hear the case of that term, which some of her conservative colleagues were pushing to do. And then months later, she actually ended up changing her vote from a grant to a deny. So it didn't make a substantive difference. You only need four votes, which Justice Alito had, to move the case forward. But it meant that the case moved forward with a bare minimum of the court, only four votes. And by the way, those were all male justices.
There's another detail in your reporting that the justices initially voted in January of 2021 to take up the case. This was months before they publicly announced that they would hear it. And you report that it was Justice Brett Kavanaugh who pushed for a delay to create the appearance of distance from Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg's death. Why did he think that was important?
So one of the things that he cited was that he wanted to watch some other abortion cases play out in the lower courts. But it's really the effect that's so interesting. It pushes the case to the next term, and also it creates this appearance of distance from Justice Ginsburg's death. The court has the vote to grant. The case is clearly moving forward, and yet they essentially withhold the decision from the public for months.
And once Justice Samuel Alito wrote that draft of his opinion and sent it to his colleagues, you report that the other conservative justices quickly signed on to it without requesting any changes. And that was Alito's way, reportedly, of trying to safeguard a coalition around overturning Roe. How and why did the leak of his opinion to Politico in May of 2022, how did that cement the ruling?
So one of our discoveries is that there were really extensive attempts to craft compromises. We don't know if they would have worked. We don't know what prospect they had at succeeding. But Chief Justice John Roberts, Justice Stephen Breyer, the first thing they did is they tried to stop the case from being heard. Then when it went forward, Justice Roberts, and this is public, he's described this at oral arguments and is in his opinion, he had a kind of 15-week compromise where he wanted to uphold the Mississippi law, which restricted abortion to 15 weeks, but he didn't want to overturn all of Roe. And he was all, even though that was a very lonely position on this court, he only needed one more vote to make that happen. And in fact, Justice Stephen Breyer was considering joining him in that position. That would have been just symbolic. But if, say, Justice Brett Kavanaugh had joined that position as well, the entire outcome would have been different. And so the leak came just as those efforts were underway, and it rendered them hopeless. Justices' votes are secret for a reason, because they want room to change their minds, which sometimes they do before the official opinion comes out. And in this case, because everything became so public, it really cemented the results and locked them in. So we don't know who leaked this opinion, but we can say what the effect was, which was to really lock in the final result.
Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Jody Kantor of The New York Times, thanks for sharing your reporting with us.
Thank you.
The Supreme Court will soon weigh in on reproductive rights again, as the justices agreed this week to hear a case about access to mifepristone for medication abortions, which make up more than half of abortions in this country. For many Americans, these Supreme Court decisions have immediate real-life implications.
And that is playing out this week in Texas, where the state Supreme Court overturned a ruling that would have allowed Dallas resident Kate Cox to terminate her non-viable pregnancy. Cox had to leave the state to get that abortion, but the ruling has broad repercussions. And it's put medical providers on the front lines of interpreting legal language while caring for their patients. We're joined now by one such medical provider. That is Dr. Amna Dermish. She's an OBGYN based in Austin, Texas. Dr. Dermish, welcome. It's so nice to have someone with my same name on the show, that we differ slightly in pronunciation. I want to ask you about this exception in the Texas law, though. There's a near total abortion ban in the state. The exception is in the case of a risk to the life of the mother. In the Kate Cox case, she said it was a risk. The court disagreed, and they said in the ruling, the exception is predicated on a doctor acting within the zone of reasonable medical judgment, which is what doctors do every day. Does that make sense to you? Do you understand what the exception encompasses?
You know, I don't, and I think that really gets to the heart of the matter, is that it's really, we've been set up as healthcare providers to be put into a situation where every medical decision that we make is being second-guessed by the legislature and the judiciary. And so physicians are placed in a situation where they are unsure whether what they consider to be their sound, reasonable judgment would be acceptable to our attorney general or to judges in the state of Texas.
You know, we spoke with Kate Cox before that court ruling. Here is just a clip of what she had to say about learning her pregnancy was non-viable.
She'll either die in my belly, or I'll carry her to term and have to deliver her stillborn. Or if she arrives into this world, you know, her life will be measured in minutes or hours or days and plagued with medical devices. She would need to be placed directly onto hospice. So imagine receiving that news and pairing that with the risks and complications of continuing the pregnancy and the childbirth.
Dr. Dermish, knowing the uncertainty you just expressed around interpreting the law, how do you talk to your patients about this kind of thing, knowing many of them will face the same thing that Kate Cox did?
Yeah, well, you know, given that there is essentially a complete ban on abortion in Texas, these conversations are really hard to have, and they're not happening in the way that they should and did even, you know, 2 years ago. You know, listening to Kate is heartbreaking because nobody should ever be in that situation. You know, we're in a situation where doctors are having to say how sick is too sick. You know, how close to death does somebody need to be? And who is allowed to make that determination? You know, patients aren't allowed to choose their own risk. You know, is it a 20% risk of death that is good enough to have an abortion in Texas, or does it need to be 70%? You know, how much blood is too much blood for somebody to lose before we can say that this is an acceptable abortion in the state of Texas? And it's an untenable situation. People are forced into these terrible choices that they're not even allowed to make. And as a physician, it's just, it's heartbreaking to be there. You know, I have the training and the capacity to provide care to these people. I live here in the state of Texas, and I am prevented from providing essential medical care to patients based on my judgment and the patient's desires by my state.
There's the mission to serve your patients. There's also the legal risk you and your colleagues face in having these discussions. What's the conversation been like among other OBGYNs in Texas?
I mean, I think there's a culture of fear that exists now. People aren't sure what is safe to say to their patients. They're unsure what kind of care they can offer their patients. And they are afraid that if they offer the standard of care, that they will be punished, that they will lose their license, they will lose their livelihood, their family will suffer. And then on the other side, you have this patient who suffers even more from this. And, you know, you go into medicine to help people, and to be held back from that is really devastating as a provider. And I think what we've seen in Kate Cox's case is that the state is determined to prevent us from practicing safe medicine. You know, we see that with the letters that the Attorney General sent to the hospitals and to the physician, threatening them if they were to proceed with providing the standard of care. And I think it's just going to continue to harm people in ways that we can't even imagine at this point.
Well, doctor, as you know, Texas is not alone in its abortion restrictions there. There's some 15 other states that have near total bans. The landscape shifts quickly as well. The Arizona Supreme Court just heard arguments about an abortion ban. Wyoming judge is now weighing whether or not to uphold a medication abortion ban. Do you consult and compare notes with other doctors in other states?
I mean, I'm fortunate to belong to an amazing community of providers across the country. And you know, in some ways it feels like a race to the bottom. And, you know, when we talk about this, the focus is always on the care that our patients need and what we can still do to help them in the face of all these restrictions. You know, our patients are terrified. You know, my colleagues are telling me that patients are leaving their phones behind when they travel across state lines to get abortion care because they are afraid that they will be tracked and they will be punished for seeking health care. That's the environment that we live in.
That is Dr. Amna Dermish, OBGYN, based in Austin, Texas, joining us tonight. Doctor, thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Senators put an aid and border mega deal atop their holiday wish list. The House takes a formal step toward impeaching the president, and the caucus kickoff to 2024's race for the presidency is less than 30 days away. That brings us to the analysis of Brooks and Marcus. That is New York Times columnist David Brooks and Ruth Marcus, columnist for The Washington Post. Jonathan Capehart is away. It's great to see you both.
Hi.
Let's start with the news late today. I just want to get your reaction that Rudy Giuliani has been ordered to pay Georgia election workers Shea Moss and Ruby Freeman almost $150 million for defamation. David, what do you make of that?
It's deserved. I mean, he ripped their lives to shreds with the tweet and with all the lies that went on. And so I think these big penalties are meant to send a message, and they are sending a message. You can't lie and destroy people's lives when you're in a position of authority. The larger story is whatever happened to Rudy Giuliani. You know, when he was mayor, I covered him. I traveled around the city with him. He was smart. He was calm. He had quirks. He was gladiatorial. But he was not the guy we see now. And it's one of the most remarkable transformations I've ever seen in journalism. And it's like what gets rotted when you're desperate for relevance. I was once having lunch decades ago now with a friend of mine named Michael Kelly, who was editing The Atlantic. And there were two former officials across the restaurant. And he pointed to them and said, look, a powerless lunch. And they had formerly held power, and now they had no power. And I think that's what Giuliani's soul to shreds. And so he deserves what he's gotten.
Ruth, what about you?
Couldn't agree more, but he did have power. He had the power to destroy their lives. I wish he could be summoned to pay the $150 million. That amount is going to be reduced. He doesn't have it. No amount of money can make up for what they suffered. He is so shameless. He continued to defame them outside the court, even as the trial was going on. He is not going to have a comfortable retirement, and he shouldn't, and couldn't happen to a nicer guy. And I mean that sarcastically for anybody who might get that wrong.
And we should note this is happening at a time of rising threats against election workers, many of them leaving their roles because they don't want to deal with it anymore. More to come on that. Meanwhile, let's turn to the Hill, because we know Senate negotiators are working to pass this foreign aid bill that includes billions for Ukraine and for Israel, held up on those border policy talks. Senator Schumer saying that the Senate will come back next week. They will hold a vote. Look, Democrats are clearly incentivized to get this across the finish line. Are Republicans equally incentivized?
No, because a lot of them, they're fine. Some of the Republicans wouldn't, they don't worry if we don't have Ukraine aid, and they love having the immigration issue. Mm. And so they have less urgency. I still somehow think it's going to get done. It just makes so much sense. Everybody gets something important they want. What's happening on the border has to be addressed. The Democrats absolutely have to address it. It's a super important issue, and Democrats are getting hammered on it. And then Ukraine has to happen. We can't let Vladimir Putin win that war. It just seems to me so obvious. The hard part is this is not, sometimes when you get 60 votes in the Senate, you get 51 votes in one party, and then you try to get 9 others from the other party. That's not going to happen here. Mm. It's going to be a 30-30. You're going to get 30 Republicans and 30 Democrats. Both sides are going to lose a lot of people. And doing that kind of deal, and we've seen bipartisan deals before, but doing a 30-30 deal when you get a majority of both parties, mm-hmm. that's super hard to do, let alone immigration, the issue that we have not made progress on since 1986.
That's correct, yeah.
And so it's going to be a tough, but it just the logic behind this deal is so strong to me that I suspect they'll eventually get it done, but you don't hear a lot of optimism right now on the Hill.
Well, what about the logic behind the Biden position on this? Because he is taking a lot of heat from the progressive wing in particular for many of these proposed immigration concessions. Is he going to lose many of the same members of the coalition that put him into office?
Yes, but I think there's actually logic on both sides. I think on the Republican side, I have a slightly different answer than David gave, because I think that many Republicans, and particularly Senate Republicans, the majority of them, are very incentivized to get the Ukraine funding, including Senator McConnell. And they know that border security has to be a piece of this. On the problem is getting it through the House. In order to get it through the House, you have to convince House Republicans that Democrats were dragged to this kicking and screaming. And so to a certain extent, the administration and advocates of getting this across the line benefit from the yelps you're hearing from the left right now. They can calm them down later. But House Republicans have very mixed motives, right? They like border security as an issue, perhaps more than they like border security as a solution. Now, from the president's point of view, this will be my last thing. He has a problem on the left, and people will be yelling at the end of this process if this all comes together. People from the left will be yelling, but he has a bigger political problem, which mm-hmm. is border security is a very motivating issue for voters that he has to get on his side in order to get reelected. So this, to some way, gives him a little bit of an excuse to do something that he wouldn't have the political freedom to do otherwise, yeah. and to say, I took steps to help solve this.
Well, David, I want to get your reaction to something Ruth said there, because it was President Biden that linked that border policy to this foreign aid package. If it does get addressed in these ways, does that take it away from Republicans as a political cudgel next year?
We're not going to totally solve the border, but maybe we won't have 10,000 asylum seekers crossing the border every. And I would say, remember, Joe Biden was the in 2020, a lot of the active groups and a lot of the Democratic politicians who are on the primary debate stage basically wanted to decriminalize the border. Yeah. Yeah, Joe Biden was one of the few Democrats to say, no, we're not going there. If they had gone there, Donald Trump would have won that election. And so I think, you know, for Joe Biden to do what he's doing now and to be not quite as progressive on the border while still being kind of progressive. It just is a political must.
And the border situation has gotten much worse since that conversation, and so he really does need to do something.
Meanwhile, in the House, let's talk about this. The Republican conference voted to open an official impeachment inquiry into President Biden. That inquiry, we should point out, in our latest poll, we've seen a slight increase in approval for them to move forward on that in the last couple of months. In October, 52% of Americans disapproved, 47% approved. By December, 48% disapproved, 49% approved. Hunter Biden, of course, on whom Republicans are hanging many of these allegations this week, defied a Republican subpoena to testify privately. He says he wants to do so publicly. And here's what he had to say about this on Wednesday.
Let me state as clearly as I can. My father was not financially involved in my business, not as a practicing lawyer, not as a board member of Burisma, not in my partnership with a Chinese private businessman, not in my investments at home nor abroad, and certainly not as an artist.
David, there's no evidence linking the president to any wrongdoing yet. Why move ahead with this vote?
Well, it's easy to go ahead and do an inquiry. There are a lot of Republicans who have no problem doing an inquiry, but there are a lot of Republicans also say, well, there's no reason for impeachment. Like, there's no evidence here. And so I do think that the inquiry was already going on, so this just continued something that was already happening. And so I think there are still a lot of Republicans who are like, okay, fine, let them have their inquiry, but unless there's some evidence.
When you say let them have their inquiry, you mean?
Jim Jordan, basically. And I will say one other thing. One of the virtues of being on book tour is I've been on like 30 or 40 cities for the last 2 months, and I've met hundreds and hundreds of people, and I've talked about Ukraine and the border and all this. How many people have asked me about Hunter Biden?
How many?
Zero.
Really?
Zero. And so I happen to think it's one of these issues that's just not resonating. People have bigger things to worry about than this.
Ruth, what's your take?
My take is that the Republican MAGA base is not going to David Brooks's book events. That's my take. I'm harsher about this impeachment inquiry. You sort of make it sound like no harm, no foul. Let them go ahead with their inquiry. This is a shameful misuse of the impeachment power and the impeachment process. Michael Gerhardt was on this program just the other night talking about how there had never been a formal impeachment inquiry in American history in the absence of credible evidence of wrongdoing. So we are looking, as you said, for it's a hunt for high crimes and misdemeanors mm-hmm. without evidence to do it. And I think it threatened because once you get this official ball rolling, then how do you stop from giving in to the demands for a vote for articles of impeachment? And then you put the 18 or so Republicans who are in districts that Biden won against Trump in a terrible position. They're either going to invite, depending on the timing, they're going to invite their base to primary them if they don't vote for it, or they're going to have their general electorate mad at them when they're trying to get reelected. And so the only smart politics of this are to assuage Trump and to assuage the base, but it's not to protect your majority.
Well, meanwhile, 30 days to go until the Iowa caucuses. Feels like a good time to remind people about many of the candidates who are still running. Mr. Trump is, of course, up 32 points compared to the other candidates. But also still running for the Republican nominations, Ron DeSantis, Nikki Haley, Vivek Ramaswamy, Chris Christie, Asa Hutchinson's campaign also continues. David, do you see anything in that field changing between now and the time the Iowa caucuses begin?
No, probably not. We are always waiting. Well, once campaigning starts in Iowa, then the numbers will begin to move around. And so campaigning has started, and the numbers are not moving around. If anything, Donald Trump is doing even better.
Yeah.
And one of the little statistics that leapt out at me is among people, Iowans who've never been to a caucus, so political novices, basically, Trump, I saw, was winning by them by 62 or 63%. So he's like swamping people, like he's bringing in new people.
Bringing in new folks too, yeah.
And so he just looks very formidable in Iowa.
He's bringing in new people and he's got an operation for how to run the caucuses that was very amateurish last time around and that is much better. Last time around being 2016 when he had a contested primary and it's gonna be much better now. It's like kind of a preview of heaven forbid, a second Trump term. He's getting smarter at doing this. And I don't think there's any reason to expect that he's not going to win the caucuses and not going to be the Republican nominee.
There was a conversation we had several months ago, I haven't heard in a while, about eventually if enough people wanted to stop him from becoming the nominee, they had to drop out, they had to coalesce behind a single candidate. Has that moment come and gone, David?
Well, he's over 50%, so it's sort of an academic argument. Mm-hmm. I think it would be useful for Chris Christie to drop out right now. and give Nikki Haley some kind of shot in New Hampshire. And it's just, as somebody pointed out, it's a rerun of 2016. The other Republicans are not attacking him. They're not dropping out. It's all the collective action problems we saw in 2016. And it's just a rerun. They've learned nothing.
It's a collective action problem. Politicians don't win if they drop out. And they're worrying about themselves first. And it wouldn't make a difference.
Ruth Marcus, David Brooks, always good to see you both. Thank you so much.
With the holidays upon us, you may be hunting for gifts for the book lovers in your life. To help narrow down the many best books of the year lists, Jeffrey Brown speaks to two NewsHour regulars for our arts and culture series, Canvas.
And joining me again this year are two top readers and reviewers, Gilbert Cruz, books editor of the New York Times, and Maureen Corrigan, book critic of NPR's Fresh Air. It's nice to see both of you again.
It's good to be
Maureen, here. I'll start with you. Shall we start with fiction?
Sure, why not?
Give us two of the
it's
many
that you
love.
It's been a great year, so two is hard. Alice McDermott's Absolution. Anybody who's read Alice McDermott knows that she usually writes about my people, Irish Catholics, working class background, New York.
I'm not.
This time she takes those characters and puts them in Vietnam in 1963. We have the main character is a newlywed, a young wife, who is pulled into this group of women who are doing charitable works in Vietnam while their husbands are busy doing something else. And without being heavy-handed, McDermott manages to make a connection between the insistent charity of these women and early American intervention in Vietnam.
Yeah, because that's something else turns out to be the Vietnam War.
Right. You gave it away. The other book that I loved, one of the other books, The Heaven and Earth Grocery Store by James McBride. Yeah. I think he's one of our most nuanced but clear-eyed writers about race. This is set in Pottstown, Pennsylvania, around 1925, in a historically immigrant Jewish neighborhood and African-American. Mm-hmm. And I'll stop there. It's amazing.
Gilbert, you want to give us two fiction, two novels?
Sure thing. So one of my favorite books of the year, one of our top books of the year, was a book called The Bee Sting by Paul Murray. Paul Murray is an Irish author. His book was shortlisted for the Booker Prize this year. And it's a family saga. It is a book about four family members who formerly were riding high on the hog, and the 2008 financial crisis is hitting Ireland, is hitting them in their little town. And it's a book that sort of digs deep down into their internal lives, their emotional lives. There are sections that go between all of the different characters. And it's a book about sort of the unknowability of people that you love. You can live with someone for a very long time and still not get to know them because you can never truly know a person. It's funny, it's sad, it's tragic, it's a lot of things. And you really fall in love with all of the characters. So that's my first one.
Okay.
Second one called North Woods, and this is by Daniel Mason. And it is set over 300 years, and rather than focus on any individual character, this plot of land and this house in Western Massachusetts is the main character. It takes you through three centuries, and it gives you all these different characters. And through these characters, Daniel Mason writes through several different genres and several different types of literary styles. It's constantly surprising. And it's just a delight to read. His writing is so beautiful.
Interesting. All four of these books have a lot of history as well as the family life to them. How about nonfiction, Maureen?
Yeah, well, here's some more history. The Wager by David Gran. He's having such a big year.
With Killers of the Flower Moon.
Mm-hmm. This work of history, narrative history, is about as traditional as you get. It's about a shipwreck, a mutiny, survival on a rocky island. A bunch of British sailors are on a ship called The Wager. That ship breaks apart in a storm in 1741 off the coast of Patagonia. And for a while, they survive on this island, and then a group of the sailors patches together a rickety vessel and sails 2,500 miles to Brazil. And that's only part of the story. So that's one of them. And then Safia Sinclair's memoir, her debut memoir, How to Say Babylon, I thought was outstanding. You know, it tells that kind of familiar story about breaking out of a repressive childhood context into a wider world. In her case, she grew up in a strict Rastafarian household. She's a lovely writer, she's a poet, and her nature descriptions of Jamaica, along with everything else, are really stunning.
Okay. Gilbert, to nonfiction?
I have to second Maureen's recommendation. All the books she is talking about are great, but I really love that one. One I will talk about is Master Slave Husband Wife by Ilyan Wu. This is a piece of historical narrative nonfiction. It is about a couple in 1848. They live in Georgia. They are an enslaved couple. And right before Christmas, they decide to make a run for it, to leave Georgia and try to escape to the north. And the way that they do this is by disguising the wife, Ellen Kraft, who is a light-skinned African-American, as a wealthy white man. And her husband sort of serves or play acts as her servant. And they make this 4-day journey. It's very tense. It's amazingly researched. That's just the first part of the story. You get a peek into their lives after they make it to the north, the way they got involved in anti-slavery advocacy. It's a historical, you know, drama. It's a love story that reads like a novel. It's quite an amazing book. The second nonfiction book I will talk about is a book called Fireweather. This one is set now. This one is set in present time. It is a climate change book, Fireweather by John Valiant. It's ostensibly about the 2016 Fort McMurray wildfire, which took place in Canada. Fort McMurray is an oil boom town. It is a place that popped up and has made great wealth for people based on extraction of oil from the ground. That extraction has led to climate change, and that climate change has led to a giant wildfire that resulted in the evacuation of almost 100,000 people in 2016. And again, it's a book that reads like a novel. It mixes a beat-by-beat account of a wildfire with the history of oil extraction, climate change. It's just masterfully done.
I want to ask you just in our short time left here about whether you're seeing any trends, either in your own reading or in the writing that's coming across your desk. Maureen? Yeah.
Well, as many people have pointed out, we're living in a time that's very much like the 30s. Our fiction, especially our literary fiction, is very much centered on social issues and social problems. I thought it was interesting, though, this year that some novels that I wouldn't have expected to see social issues crop up in, especially reproductive rights, all of a sudden those novels veered into an abortion rights plot, which was Megan Abbott's suspense novel, Beware the Women, and also to a certain extent Ann Patchett's novel Tom Lake had that. So we're very much socially conscious in our art these days.
Gilbert, what are you seeing?
There are tons and tons of historical fiction novels out there. I feel like this genre, if you can call it a genre, just continues to grow and grow. To mention a book that Maureen just mentioned, Tom Lake, that is one of at least three books set during the pandemic that came out this summer and fall. Michael Cunningham had a book. Sigrid Nunez had a book. I think we'll continue to see books set during the pandemic. And then there's this subgenre that has been around for a while and has ruled sort of part of the bestseller list this year, which is romantasy. We have written about it at the Times. Lots of places have written about it, which is a mix of romance and fantasy. And the author Rebecca Yarros, with her books Fourth Wing and Iron Flame, sort of really dominated the bestseller list this year.
All right. Some of the best books of the year. Gilbert Cruz of the New York Times, Maureen Corrigan of NPR's Fresh Air. Thank you both very much once again.
Thank you.
And you can check out the full book list on our website. That's pbs.org/newshour.
And there's always a lot more online, including a story about the challenges faced by the nation's only mental health hotline specifically for and operated by transgender people. That's at pbs.org/newshour. And tune into Washington Week with The Atlantic tonight on PBS. Our guest moderator, Franklin Foer, and his panel discuss the convergence of political problems that could hinder President Biden's reelection.
And on Saturday's PBS News Weekend, a look at why Pope Francis advocating for church reform is creating divisions between some conservative American Catholics and the Vatican. And that is the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Jeff Bennett.
And I'm Amna Nawaz. On behalf of the entire NewsHour team, thank you for joining us.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
our economy for 160 years. BNSF, the engine that connects us.
And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions, and friends of the NewsHour, including Kathy and Paul Anderson, and Camilla and George Smith. The Walton Family Foundation, working for solutions to protect water during climate change so people and nature can thrive together. The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation, for more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world at hewlett.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.